This week's episode is brought to you by Solo, a Star Wars story.
Wait, you're serious?
Well, not really, but I figured, no, they can use all the advertising they want, you know.
I can't imagine they'd be upset.
Yeah. So everyone, it's a prequel about Han Solo, you know, kind of how he gets the Millennium Falcon. Wait, hold on, I'm getting a phone call. Hello? Yeah? Oh. Oh, all right. Well, okay, bye. Yeah, that was Disney. We're being sued. Kevin, I hope that our podcast doesn't get canceled for racist tweets, because we've sent a lot of racist tweets. Just kidding.
Well, I just feel like if you just constantly do racist tweets, then you just...
It's scale, just what you're known for.
You could just scale back slightly. They're just like, wow, he's really changed.
Yeah, it's like a rehab thing. What was it? I think Ricky Gervais had a joke about, like, someone who doesn't drink, and it's like, no one cares, but if you stop drinking, people care.
Exactly. You want to do that with racism.
Yeah. Whites only. Just kidding. This podcast for everyone.
It has been canceled for racism.
Oh, okay. Goodbye. Hello. Welcome to the Hodge Podcast, the official podcast, countryhodgepodge.com. I'm your host, Steve Hodge. Joining me, as always, is my co-host, cousin, and lover, Kevin Hodge.
Hello.
This week, we are going to talk about... Actually, we could talk about the website and kind of the future plans of the website. And then also, we could briefly mention NoFX being the worst people in the world. And then we have an interview with America Noir artist, which is an awesome name.
I love it.
Better than Maripolitan. Sorry, Dale. with America Noir artist Ben De La Cour, who is a fantastic fucking artist. If you don't know, America Noir is Americana and folk, and it's just really good. So we have about a 20-minute conversation with him, which was fun, and he was busy, so we didn't want to hold him forever, because otherwise we can usually talk to artists all day, and it's always fun.
Because we are great, and everyone likes to talk to us.
Yeah, everyone knows Country Hodgepodge, even though they answer the phone, and they're like, who is this?
Why are you calling? Normal banter.
Exactly. Who are you? How'd you get this number? The usual.
Please leave me alone. Restraining order.
But, so, our pod site. I had the word correct, and I was second.
And I'm a doctor, too.
I'm a doctor, too. So, countryhodgepodge.com, it's been around for coming up on a year, which has been a lot of fun, except for the fact that we're really bad at writing articles.
Yeah, and so everyone who's been, like, patiently waiting for us to post more...
It's been over 3 months since our last article.
More terrible articles that follow the exact same format and don't really give you any sort of news.
So we decided that we've gotten requests for reviews still. Because I have the email, but we still get requests for reviews and stuff. And I'm always just like, yeah, but we're not really good.
Yeah, and I feel like we could, you know, just spitballing out loud while recording. I feel like that's something that we could still reference as part of the podcast.
Yeah,
if we listen to something, we like it a lot. Let everyone know
for sure.
You know, something like that. But as you probably noticed through our inability to have grammar when we talk, it doesn't translate to the keyboard either.
Yeah.
So our ability to write reviews is not an ability.
Yeah,
because it doesn't exist.
So we decided that we're going to kind of scale. Even though I looked at the analytics, which is crazy, that we still get thousands of views on the website, which is really weird. So thank you to
everyone that is visiting.
But,
I love you all.
We're
going to pivot slightly.
Yeah. So we're going to not focus on if we still have songs we want to recommend. Yeah, we might throw up an article every once in a while, or if there is something that we do feel like we could spend, you know, write 5,000 words on a song, on an album, I'll do it. I'm not like against writing. It's just when it's not an actual job we have, it's a very time-consuming habit hobby. And so it's just kind of like, we need to scale it back. So we're going to change just the website.
To get the amount of content up that would support having a website that's based on articles.
And if you know anything about starting a business or anything like that, is if the field is already flooded with content of similar nature, you're just going to get lost.
Thank God there's none of that.
Thankfully Whiskey Rift doesn't exist. So we're just kind of focus on the podcast more, because this is what we really like doing, is the podcast. Is we enjoy every week being like arguing over songs and why Kevin's top 10 is wrong and mine is right. And, you know,
that has never happened.
And so we want to focus more on the podcast. So the website's going to be more of kind of a portal to help connect the podcast.
Yeah. And we're going to try to throw up some more info related to each podcast. Cause right now we kind of, we record it and then we tweet it out and whatever. And so you can see it that what we did, but we're going to try to do a little bit more ahead of time.
Which we used to do. We used to have articles of albums that came out or the artists we were talking about or their best songs. We used to do articles about that. So we want to get back to that.
And we used to do so many things.
We used to actually put a lot of content on the website. We used to do about two a day, but so we want to focus more on the podcast more so than the website. And it's also a brand that we enjoy that we've created, and we don't want to let it die. And so we want to keep all that kind of alive.
Bottom line is we will be putting more things on the website, but it's going to be a little different.
Yeah.
And so
it's going to look a lot different, too. We're going to revamp the whole thing.
So we'll talk about that more when we get it done and whatnot. But that's what's happening on this side of the river.
Yeah, so before we get into the interview, we can also mention briefly, I just saw who the hell was it that shared it? It was
Tony Jackson,
shared this TMZ article that at some NoFX concert, who I guess they're a punk band or something.
I can't name a specific song, but I know that I've heard of them.
Yeah, but they were having a concert, and they're like, oh, we sang a song about Muslims and we didn't get shot. And it's like, well, one, that's one step too far. And then he goes, yeah, I guess that only happens at country concerts, which is another step too far. And he goes, thank God country fans died and not punk fans. And it's just like, go fuck yourself.
Yes, because the genre that named itself after being fucking dickheads to society, thank God those fans are around.
Yes.
Not that I would ever wish anything bad on punk fans, but
not that I'd wish anything bad on any fans or of anything, but to say like thank God we're alive and they died, it's like
it's
fuck
just
you.
The ultimate dickhead nonsense. And they were in Vegas
in
Vegas talking to people who probably
in the article
they were affected by it in some way.
Yeah,
because
in the article it said that most people were like backing off of that. They're like, whoa, like no one was like agreeing with it. And then he's like, and then I guess the singer goes like, oh, you're thinking it too. It's like, no, they're probably not.
No,
because if there's a shooting in your town, you're not gonna be like, well, thank God that
the normal reaction is not fuck them, thank God it was them. Like no one thinks that.
It was just such a dick fucking thing to say.
So fuck them.
But
so hard.
But on a higher note, better note, a gooder note, gooder,
that's it. See what I was talking about with the grammar? Doesn't exist.
Jimothy. anyway.
It's your baby pee-pee.
Kevin is still finishing up the office.
I'm almost there, folks.
He's
powering through.
He got through the bad season. Now he's finishing with the better season. Still not great, but
I was not a fan of season 8.
Season 8 was not good. But anyway, so there's no transition to this. Here's a conversation we had with Ben de la Cour. Enjoy. I wanna get it jacked up. Let's crank it on up. I know, Kevin, you had a question.
Oh, I have a bunch of questions.
Oh, well, obviously.
I was just kind of interested. I was looking at your biography. You've lived quite a life thus far, at least in travels and whatnot. And I was just wondering, does the traveling help inspire the stories, or have you always felt the need to move around and come to new places, and it just kind of happened to be a byproduct?
It's kind of hard to say. Maybe one informs the other to a degree, but honestly, I think that a lot of the most interesting people I know kind of kind of write these songs that are, you know, very broad-ranging and unique and specific. And a lot of them have hardly been anywhere, you know. And then, you know, we all have people who just travel all around and they just seem to come back even dumber and more close-minded than they were when they left. You know, so I really think it's kind of what you take from everything. So I feel like, you know, even if traveling around and living in a bunch of places does improve and inform your songwriting, it's surely a very self-indulgent way to do it.
Yeah, sure.
You know, there's less self-indulgent ways you could do it.
Yeah. What kind of... obviously, we saw that you had kind of... Well, you started playing dive bars when you were really young. How'd you kind of grab that gig and kind of get on that train?
I mean, honestly, growing up in New York, they really didn't, you know, this is like in the 90s, they didn't care. You could go to the Spiral, and you could go to CBGB, you could go to those kind of places, and, you know, they'd sneak you in the back, and you'd play, and then they'd run you out, maybe be able to drink a couple of half-empty beers you found lying around, some growing up to buy you a beer, you know, it's just kind of like just, you know, you know, we're probably 12 years old.
Oh, nice. Yeah, that's awesome.
That's amazing.
What kind of, we saw that you kind of went to playing with playing metal and stuff. What kind of, how do you make the transition from metal to kind of the Americana or American noir, as you call it, genre? How does, like, where's that kind of mind's travel, kind of?
I guess I would describe myself as a pretty reluctant metalhead. You know, like, I always enjoyed metal from kind of when I was in my, you know, I was a huge Slayer fan when I was a kid, and
sure,
I mean, still am, but I'd always, you know, I grew up listening to a lot of folkier, you know, acoustic, I guess, like, proto-Americana stuff, and, you know, even, like, on our tour van that we had, you know, all three of us, we'd be, like, you know, play some, you know, some awful metal show somewhere and then load up for the drive, and, you know, we'd be playing like Captain Beefheart or Jackson Brown or Townes Van Zandt or something, like, you know, in the van.
Hell,
so it's kind of like, seemed almost like a logical conclusion that I got bored of playing metal and also wanted to tour in a manner that was kind of more stripped down, and I was like, oh, you know, I can try to write these songs. I wrote this kind of songs since I started writing songs anyway. I mean, they were really bad, but it was kind of like I'd already, you know, but it kind of was like, what is that saying, like, switching for a different seat on the Titanic, you know? It's like, oh, even more obscure than metal music. It's like, oh, solo, folky, acoustic guitar.
Yeah, absolutely.
Nonsense, you know, but whatever.
Yeah.
Awesome. A different kind of hipster crowd.
Yeah.
Right, or of a very thin crowd.
Tell me about the term American noir. Where did that come from?
I don't know. I literally think I was just sitting around one day, and I was like, thought it up and started kind of laughing to myself, and I was like, well, shit, if it amuses me, who cares? You know, that's basically like my MO is to abuse myself.
Absolutely.
You know, like, I've got Folk Hero tattooed on my knuckles. That would be really fucking funny. And a lot of people think it's really dumb, and they're, you know, they're right. I also find it funny.
I think it's awesome. That's great.
You know, I was like, and it's kind of, yeah. So, you know, it kind of, it seemed like, I love kind of, sorry, I'm trying to multitask to just put my daughter to sleep for a while. She's teething, and now I'm also trying to make a pasta sauce.
Oh, damn.
So,
you're accomplishing more things than I'll do for the rest of the week.
Well, I mean, it's probably not a very good pasta sauce.
Yeah, that's awesome. Did you ever kind of, obviously, were from the site Country Hodgepodge and all that, but we enjoy Americana and folk, and are there any kind of, obviously you said Townes Van Zandt and Jackson Brown, and kind of, what kind of, who are the biggest kind of influences that kind of got you into this genre?
Well,
Were there any country artists, or is it kind of always been Americana folk kind of stuff?
I mean, I kind of consider towns to be on the border of country and folk.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, really very, you know, I mean, I love Gary Stewart.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Out of the country people.
Yeah.
Probably, I think, for my money, the greatest country singer of all time. And also, one of the most interesting, you know, he wrote a lot of those songs. And he.
Yeah.
Just very unique and very, just very awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely kind
of. Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, you're fine. I definitely miss out on a lot of the Nashville big country explosion, you know. It wasn't something my world was, and I'm kind of glad for it. Still, you know, I can appreciate Garth Brooks and stuff, but it's definitely not something I would ever.
Yeah. No, that's
Crystal Dew is pretty awesome.
Oh yeah, for sure. Gotta love an independent. But yeah, because that's kind of the thing with when how we said on our podcast, we kind of talk shit about this kind of stuff because we've been leaning Americana and folk more and more recently because they're the ones who are kind of staying true with what they're saying. Whereas all this pop shit that gets thrown on the radio that they're calling country ain't really country anymore. So. Obviously, when we got the email, you know, kind of to talk with you, we're like, well, of course, I mean, even if he's not calling him country, he's a hell of a lot more country than the shit that we're hearing on the radio. So
oh, yeah.
This is something we would want to expose people to.
Yeah, I mean, I love Merle Travis, I love Merle Haggard, I love Merle Travis, I get it. He's kind of proto-country, you know?
Yeah,
obviously, Hank, sure. Not really a Hank Jr. fan, but definitely, I mean, Hank Sr. had a huge... You know, he's definitely one of the people you draw to.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of just beautiful language, but really a lot of depth to it, but a lot of economy.
Yeah,
absolutely. And I feel like the main issue that I have with the modern country is the abandonment of songwriting. And when we get to talk to someone like you who is such a prolific songwriter, I always, you know, ask about your opinions on that. I know, obviously, shit-talking pop country, but did you feel that the Americana realm, you know, in the American noir, like you say, is that it's so much easier to write songs? Well, I guess not easier to write songs, but it's a better format for writing songs?
Well, I mean, I think that honestly... You know, you put those limitations on yourself, and I think that the Americana world is just as cynical and fame-driven, and you know, as the top 40 country. You know, I think there's, you know, we call them hat acts. You know, like these guys have like $300 hats and moved to Nashville from Los Angeles, and you know, they got the blue denim shirt and the you know black pants and they think of themselves as Guy Clark, but they're a lot closer to like you know country music Guy Fieri, you know, or like a you know, and they think it just like you know it's kind of like a meme. It's like you know listens to Graham Parsons once.
I
love Graham Parsons. I've loved him since I was a kid too.
Yeah, I've seen a bunch of memes lately about that, showing that as much as we love Americana, the roots people kind of fall into the same trap where you know country singers nowadays, you know, you got to wear your. Well, I guess they used to wear hats. Now they're just a bunch of douchebags wearing backwards hats. But they all have the same look. But then Americana people today will have the same hipster-looking hat, the tight jeans, and follow the exact same formula.
And I find that way, you know, because you know, say what you want, right? You have like in the country world, you have like Bobby Braddock and people like that who are just riding out of control and have you know incredible songs.
Yeah.
From, it feels like a millennia, right? But then you have these people who, you know, okay, maybe a lot of these Americana acts write their own songs, but they're not good. They don't care any more about the craft than
absolutely.
Than like all the people who moved here because of Garth Brooks. You know, at least those people who moved here because of Garth Brooks had the sense to realize a lot of them that they were not writers, you know, so they looked for writers. These guys are all kind of like what happened to the major labels when they got, this isn't a unique perspective I have. I heard someone talk about it, but they were, it may have been Frank Zappa when he said that, you know, it used to be that Alan Erkin and all those guys had the big label. You know, they were old white guys in suits, but they didn't have their finger on the hipster pulse, but they were willing to give stuff a try, you know?
Yeah.
Like, because they were like, well, you know, like, but now that they're all run by, like, 30s, 40-something dudes in, like, jeans, you know, these guys think they're part of the zeitgeist, so they are going to be way less likely to take on someone doing something kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Than these guys who were, like, you know, old dudes in suits were, you know, because these guys think that they're, like, they think they're part of the scene. They think they're the songwriters, you know?
Oh, for sure.
When in reality, they're just a bunch of assholes. Right? Like, you know?
Absolutely.
At least the assholes of yore knew that they didn't really, you know, they might know a hit for sure, but they also realized that they might miss out on the hit. So they were like, yeah, let's give this a shot. Now it's like if you don't have a certain person in Nashville producing your albums, who's producing all of the Americana albums, and like, good luck to you, man. You know, like, you know, the tastemakers are not, there's not really much of an open, you know, scene. I think it's cool that, like, at least the folks are singing about more inclusive things, which I'm all about, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I think that the craft is not necessarily, I mean, I think there's less craft in the song than there were in the, you know, the 30 days of Music Row. You know, at least in the days of Music Row, Chris Christopherson, John Prine, Towns, Guy Clark, all those guys go down and get publishing deals, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and speaking of just, you know, doing something interesting and different, I wanted to ask you about the feel of your latest album, and it just kind of has like a darker tone, and then like the song specifically Tupelo, I really like the sound of it, and I just thought it was really interesting because I was just listening and I was not prepared for when it like kind of twists, and I was like, is he like murdering this lady, what the fuck?
Yeah, you got it.
So like, where does something like that come from? Is it just a natural songwriting, or was just like, I want to do something different, or like, how does that kind of thing happen?
It's very much a little bit of both. I usually don't sit down and, you know, plan to write a song about something.
Sure.
I usually let the song go where it goes, but that song I kind of realized pretty quickly where I wanted to go, and then I just had to figure out, you know, so it took a long time to write, but yeah, I mean, I definitely feel like, you know, that one I wanted to kind of make a conscious effort to,
yeah,
to write something that was, you know, I'm a huge fan of Nick Cave, the Bad Seeds, and also Warren Zevon. Those are probably, Nick Cave, Warren Zevon, and Towns are probably my favorite songwriters of all time. And so,
absolutely,
you know, I feel like kind of like I wanted the album. You know, we recorded the album almost completely live, just in one room, no headphones, and
wow,
just a couple overdubs here and there. And I just wanted it to sound dark, and I wanted it to sound, you know, live. And I wanted the songs to take weird, I wanted, you know, weird sonic textures on there that were, you know, that's, you know, might catch people unaware.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah, because we're digging the new album. It's awesome. But,
thank you.
Yeah. Do you have any kind of, like, tours or anything planned? Or I don't know what you're kind of doing right now. I haven't checked your...
I tour pretty much constantly. Well, I say constantly, about 150 days a year.
Yeah, that's, okay, that's pretty damn constant in my mind.
Yeah, it certainly feels that way.
Yeah, of course, not.
I just got home yesterday, and then I go to Canada in a week and a half or 2 weeks, and then for a little while. I mean, it's just starting to work on my next record in July, so I'll be home a lot in July.
Oh, awesome.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Definitely looking forward to that one.
Going to be coming through Iowa anytime in the future? That's just where we are.
You know, it's funny you say that. I will, and I do. I was just at Vaudeville Muse in Des Moines, maybe 3 weeks ago.
All right.
But I will be playing in Iowa dates, but I'm definitely going to be in the Midwest in, I think, very late July and early August.
Awesome.
Good deal.
We'll definitely have to keep our eyes out for that one. Yeah. But, yeah, we don't want to hold you too long, because obviously you're busy. Do you have any, like, thing you kind of want to plug, any dates or social medias or any of that kind of stuff?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the usual. Check out my, you know, my social, you know, Ben Delacour. If you just Google my name, Ben, D-E-L-A-C-O-U-R, comes up with all my, on my socials. You know, I got the new album came out last month, The High Cost of Living Strange.
Yeah, so, we'll definitely put all that in there.
Stream it, buy it, whatever you want to do. It's,
yeah, we'll definitely link it all in the podcast, and I think some people can click on it. But
one last thing that I gotta ask, especially related to the last album, the album cover. I love it, but what is going on?
I don't know. I just think up these things, and then I find people who can.
Because
I'm not much of a photographer, but I have these. pictures in my mind, and I'm like, yeah, we gotta shoot it outside my shed, and then we gotta have this guy dressed as a clown, and then we'll get, my roommate has this devil dog, we'll get the dog in there, and I'm like, yeah, I know, I'll get my wife to put on a cow mask and hide in the shed, and, you know,
yeah, I was
just kind of you know, it's fun for me, you know, people bitch about having to do everything when you're, mostly independent artist, but, you know, you can bitch about it, or you can use it to your advantage and use it to create something.
I would consider it more freeing than anything, being able to pick what you want to do for it.
I agree. I find it very, very kind of liberating.
Yeah.
You know, but a lot of people don't want to be liberated.
Yeah, just like seeing the people who are kind of, like we always talk about on the podcast, if someone is just releasing a song, you know, someone told them to record, and it's just like, how can you live doing that? I mean, I guess if you're getting paid 8 figures to do it, then maybe, but
I don't think most of these people are, though. You know, I think it's more a question of, you know, I mean, that's the problem, right? Like, people act like, oh, well, I could just put on a cowboy hat and do this and be famous too. It's like, actually, bro, I'm pretty sure you couldn't. Like, it's a lot harder than you think to sell out.
Yeah,
so that's why I don't even really try, because if I thought I could succeed in selling out, I would. And I think the truth is that most people would, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I mean, if I only had to write one or two songs that I hated, and then, you know,
coast
successful and could make music that I like, I would do, you know, most people would do it.
Yeah.
Like in a second, you know? And, but the problem is that 99% of times, even bigger artists who you see attempting to, quote unquote, sell out, all that happens is people don't give a shit, and then on top of that, they're just left with really bad art.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like you have the worst of both worlds. At least if you're creating on your own terms and no one buys it, you're like, well, at least I made art on my own terms.
Yeah.
Like, ultimately, you know, it's not easy getting your ego out of the way, but once you can get your ego out of the way and realize you're here to make art, and this will get you into it in the first place, which, I mean, don't get me wrong, I don't know how I succeed in doing that by any measure, but I try to focus on it, then you're like, all right, like, I can, you know, like, the art is what counts, is make, try to make good art.
Yeah, definitely.
Put the art back in artists.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, definitely. All right, well, thank you for reaching out and talking with us about this. We just, like we said, we love just introducing people into music that they may not know, or, because obviously we could make a podcast about Luke Bryan and remind you that he exists, even though everyone knows, or we could tell people about artists who we think deserve the spotlight.
Yeah, people who you should be listening to.
Yeah, we're selfish that way, but whatever.
Yeah.
Well, like, it's good that your selfishness and my selfishness can intersect.
Yeah, so we
exactly.
Make a bunch of money somehow.
Yeah,
yeah, absolutely. Definitely. All right. Well, yeah. Thank you again.
Thank you again for this.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Yep.
Appreciate it.
Yep.
Bye. We'll see you all in Iowa.
Yeah, hell yes.
Come on by.
Yes. All right, have a good one.
You too.
Yep, bye. Yeah, I want to get it jacked up. Yeah, let's drink it all up. Yeah. And we're back.
Yeah, and we're back.
Yeah, so it, as always, the conversation starts off awkward because I don't know how to talk to people because I'm a fucking moron. But it was still a fun conversation.
No rebuttal. That's correct.
And I enjoy, and I like hearing, because he had influences that I hadn't really heard of before.
Oh, he
and,
for sure name dropped a bunch of people.
Yeah, and so
like,
I was just like, these are people I want to check out because if they're influencing that kind of music, which I'll end the podcast with a song by him. If they're influencing that kind of music, that's awesome because
his
music is fantastic.
Well, yeah, and when one of your main you know influences and persons that he really liked, Townes Van Zandt, like Townes Van Zandt's amazing.
Yeah,
and so like if they're you know in the same sentence as him, I prefer
Van Zandt, but
City Van Zandt, super overrated.
What about Suburban Dad Van Zandt? He's great. If you're kind of saying that's your influence, and I remember I think in his bio he said like Black Sabbath was one he grew up listening to. I do like he was the reluctant metalhead. Like, he's just like, no, this is kind of what I wanted to do, and so I enjoy that he stepped into the, like, it's like Cody Jinks was in a rock band, but he's definitely more fitting in a fucking country setting because he is fantastic there. So
he is arguably perfect.
Yeah. I don't know.
I'm not biased.
I don't know if it's an argument.
Exactly.
I think he's just genuinely a perfect
Factually perfect.
But yeah. But it's not about Cody. It's about Ben.
No.
And he's great.
He is. Honestly, though, check all his stuff out on Spotify.
Yeah.
His latest album, I really apologize for not having the title of it ready for me to look up so that I could. It was like something about being strange. High cost of living strange. I really liked it. It's got this, you know.
It's only
kinda,
what, 8 tracks?
Yeah.
So it's a quick listen. Too.
Yeah, and we kind of talk about it during our conversation with Ben. But it's, you know, it's kind of got this darker feel to it that's really unique and interesting.
Yeah.
And it's Americana and kind of folky, and it's just really good. So check it out for sure.
Yeah, definitely. So I don't know if we really have anything else to say this week. Have you been listening to anything?
I've been on a kick lately of, I guess, I don't know. I'm just going to look up the Daily Mix so I can describe some of the people that are on it.
Daily Mix, if you guys have Spotify, listen to your Daily Mixes. They always, because it's songs that they know you listen to a lot, and then they mix in songs that are related to
it. I remember when I made the switch. I made the switch from listening to the weekly Discover Weekly. Yeah. I switched from listening to that to just going through the Daily Mixes because the Daily Mixes, you know, instead of all new shit that you may or may not like, it's a bunch of shit that you already like because you saved it and then some stuff that's related. And
yeah.
So you find new music that way, but it's way more accurate. But yeah, so I've been listening to this Daily Mix a lot, and it's got Jimmy Buffett, the band, Little Feet, Lucas Nelson, OAR. There's some Dave Matthews Band on there, so I'm sure you're excited about that. Grateful Dead, Marshall Tucker. Like, it's got, like, modern roots rock hippie stuff, but then also the old man hippie stuff, and I really like it.
Kevin is a dad who has no kids.
Yeah, I'm really excited about just buying, like, 15 Hawaiian shirts in, like, the next month. Because I'm going to do it, and it's going to be great.
Beautiful. but I went out of order. Because albums of last week, there was a good chunk. I got to
scroll. Oh, yeah. What came out last week?
There was first the Church Sisters, A Night at the Opry. They're like bluegrass, but their album is a little more contemporary sounding, but it's still really good. They're both, it's like twin, like 19-year-old sisters or something like that, and they're really fucking talented. Then there was Hillary Williams, My Lucky Stars. It's like Americana country rock. She's one of the many thousands of granddaughters of Hank Williams. So she's...
What?
Yeah, so she's fantastic. I think that family has something going for them. Then there's
nothing.
The Travelin' McCurries, which is a self-titled. They're a bluegrass band. Phenomenal. Then Davison Brothers Band, Fighter. I was torn on including this one just because they're like a southern rock band, which if you take it as southern rock, you'll enjoy it. But they also have kind of a Brantley Gilbert sound to it, and they have kind of one of those like metalhead type, like like that attitude
there's I feel like there's a very fine line with that because like one of the songs that I had on my daily mix, my brain is broken. Just a helicopter flying by, and all I can think about is someone got fucked up and is now being airlifted to the hospital.
You're okay.
But one of the songs I put on my picks playlist this week was by Chris Colston, And he's kind of got that same deal.
Yeah, I listened to your list, and when that one came up, I was like, that's a very Brantley Gilbert sounding.
And so it's one of those where, like, I really like that song, and I think he's, like, right on that edge where he hasn't gone... he hasn't gone to there yet, and so I really like it. And that, and I feel like that's a really well-written song. It's a breakup song. Exactly. So it's not full of... It's just a little bite.
Yeah, I did enjoy it, but yeah, I definitely caught that. I was like, well, Kevin threw like a Brantley Gilbert-ish song on here. Crazy.
I know. It was very interesting.
But yeah, so again, you can find Ben De La Cour on Facebook and Twitter. I don't know if he's on Instagram. I haven't checked. But if you go to Ben, I'm guessing like bendelacour.com or something, we'll have it in the thing.
We'll
you can find
figure
shit.
It out.
Listen to it on Spotify, buy it on iTunes, as he said, you know, do the stuff.
Do that thing.
Yeah, but you can find us at countryhodgepodge.com on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, Country Hodgepodge. On Spotify, you can find the Hodge Podcast Picks, where every week we put up songs, as long as they're on Spotify, that we talked about that week, that you can listen to in full, and you can listen to songs from literally every episode we've had so far, so 60 episodes of
It's getting
music.
Remarkably long.
It's a very...
That is not what she said.
No. But, no, it's getting to the point where if I add, like, a top 10 from an artist we've done, it'll be like, do you want to add duplicates? And it's like, we've already talked about that because we talk about a lot of music. But, yeah, so Hodge Podcast Picks. Also on a link through the website, or if you search the username Donkey Factory, one word.
Greatest name of all time.
That's Kevin's Spotify. You can find Kevin's Picks of the Week, which we also tweet out every Monday, this week Tuesday, because Memorial Day, we didn't do it.
I forgot that Monday existed.
Yeah, it was a nice three-day weekend, and I want one again. Oh, I have one this weekend. Never mind.
Son of a bitch!
So, yeah, Kevin's Picks of the Week, he puts up 10 new songs. As we said, there's the Brantley Gilbert clone, but better kind of song up there. He does a lot of... I can't remember who else you had up here this week. It was a bunch of good
It was
shit.
A bunch of random shit, too. Yeah. Well, the one guy, Drew Fishband. Why is it so hard to say Drew Fishband?
Because you're drunk.
Not currently. Yesterday. That was the first song that I had thrown onto my potential picks thing, like I was going to put on the list.
In the prelims.
And I kind of went off of like their artist radio and then listened to a lot of their stuff because I was really digging it because they kind of have like a Randy Rogers, Wade Bowen sound to them.
Yeah, I liked that song. I saved that one.
So check out some of their stuff too. It's good.
And then Friday's New Music, which we tweet out obviously every Friday. It's where we talk about the albums that come out that day and just you can find like the best new albums. Every week there's honestly usually at least three albums that come out every Friday that you can listen to. So I've already heard probably 200 albums this year of music that has come out.
Oh yeah, there's insane. A lot of music that literally every week, and it's amazing how
so
that
every
happens.
Friday you can find new, and it's gotten to the point where there was like this stupid video that the Opry shared of this guy named Michael Ray performing, and I was like, I don't know who the fuck this is.
You
but
mean
he has
douchey McTattoo face?
Yeah, he's got a fucking full sleeve tribal tattoo, like the coolest guy I've seen at the gym.
Like totally not a white dude.
Yeah, and Kevin's like, I'm pretty sure you've heard of him. I'm like, probably, but we listen to so much music now that I forget people I don't care about.
I still, like, there's just a part of me that always still pays attention to the people that I hate because I'm just like, I have to know my enemy.
I mean, a
good
chunk of them I do hate, but if it's like one of those guys who's
enemy.
Just so... Like, but Brett Young, I forget, exists all the time because he's so useless.
Mix him and Michael Ray up all the time.
Yeah, well, because like we say, it's just
one is douchey tattoo
famous,
man. And
famous
the other
artists
one is,
now, they're just generic white guys. They all look the fucking same.
Exactly.
Every single one of them looks the same.
Yep.
And yeah. So yeah. But anyway, on the link to the site or on tpublic.com, you can find one of our dumb shirts if you want to get them. I'm going to, once I remember to, I'm going to put up one of Kane Brown. It says, my eyes aren't too far apart because his eyes are too far apart. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at @CHP_Clifftron. You can find Kevin on Twitter and Instagram at @CHP_Trutch.
I got over 100 Twitter followers.
Yeah, like 60.
Follow me, people.
Fuck you, Gumby.
I tweet more than you do.
That's true. I don't really tweet. Please rate and review the podcast on iTunes. It'll help us get found. Like it on SoundCloud. Share the links. Share
the
love. The
followers on SoundCloud look to me like it went up recently.
Probably.
It's over 30.
I've just been looking at the play counts. And, just a few days ago, we passed all of 2017 in plays. So we've had literally double... the listenership has literally doubled since last year. And then, again...
So thank you to all of you.
For the fifth month this year, which is the only... There's only been 5 months.
What?
Yeah, I know. We've once again had the most listens of the year. So our listening is only going up. So thank you to everyone who tells people about the podcast and shares it.
We love you all. You're great. Yeah, and you have great taste because you're listening to the shit that we're telling you that you should also listen to. So you have great taste.
Even if you find us annoying, I hope you find good music.
Even if you find Steve annoying, I'm glad you put up with him.
Don't put up with him. But yeah, so that's it for this week. Next week, we're going to be talking about Sam Hunt. We were going to this week, but you know, we had the interview. So we're just got to delay Sam Hunt for another week. So.
Wow.
Yes. Until next week, I'm Steve Hodge. As always, joined by Kevin Hodge, saying goodbye, good night, and good Charlotte.
She said, Jesus Christ, thank God you saw. Think I can get a ride. I've been out here since forever. I told her, come on and get inside. We sat there for a second. I asked her which way we should go. She said, I don't care where you point this thing. Just get me out of Tupelo. Said you must be a Christian, you seem like a good man. I said I don't believe I'm either, but we're all doing what we can. It was cold as hell outside that night, the street was lined with snow. It was Christmas Eve somewhere else, not down in Tupelo. Tupelo, oh, oh. She said her daddy died in Memphis when I like the king. Naked face down on a bathroom floor, probably never even felt a thing. As she smoked down her last cigarette, I felt the darkness grow. She said, I never knew it got so cold down here in Tupelo. Tupelo. Her eyes roll over white in a tangled seatbelt spider web and the blue-green dashboard light. It seems like everywhere you turn, your back's against the wall. Hell, if I could live again, might not even live at all. I dumped her clothes behind a truck stop off of Highway 45. The snow was coming down so thick that it was hard to even drive. Some things you choose all by yourself, some things they choose you. I guess it wasn't Memphis, but it was gonna have to do. We come into this world of screaming, and that's how most of us will go. I turned that car around, and I headed back down to Tupelo. Tupelo.